So it's a big honor for me to be here and just making presentation on this conference. So you see the title of the presentation, so that's about institutionalizing self-reflection from cross-cultural cooperation to cross-cultural synergy. So the main part of the title is taken from the two very important thinking directions. One for the self-reflection, so you know that's a very old slogan and principle. Let's begin from Sapere Aude to Johann Gottlieb Fichte. And institutionalizing of the ideas and movements and so on, that is from the sociology, which begins with Max Weber, and then goes further to the phenomenological sociology and creates very important movement in the 20th century sort. So while I'm just speaking about the institutionalization of the self-reflection, so I think that this idea, and I know that you're a little bit tired, and I will try to skip to the big idea, that the idea of the self-reflection is a common thing for all cultures and all civilizations, and I think that is a very important idea which can transform and change relations between the cultures and continents, and between also between people, and it can be helped to understand each other. If we just go through the brief history of self-reflection, we will see that the self-reflection is the same thing as in the Eastern culture as the meditation. So when we meditate, we reflect on ourselves, and in Eastern culture, self-reflection has taken as a unique possibility, as possibility which is not common to every person, which you should train yourself to reach this kind of the level. And by this, so big movements, self-reflection, understanding yourself, becomes the axis of civilization we are used to call East. All you know, the Plato's cave myth, and that's kind of the beginning of by the many famous thinkers, the cave myth of the Plato is the beginning of the European civilization. In the cave myth, Plato sets, sort of different interpretations, like from the German romantist to Martin Heidegger, Plato's cave myth is the setting of the self-reflection as an ultimate goal for every human. So you can reach success by self-reflection yourself, by self-reflect yourself, and by this you can reach sun, as it is in the myth, and it means success also. In the Middle Ages, in the beginning, so these two versions of the self-reflections was exist. So in the East, that was a unique possibility of the human, and in the West, it was a kind of the unique strategy for everyone. But in the Middle Ages, the attitude toward self-reflection and understanding of self-reflection has changed by the establishing of the Neo-Confucianism in the East, the self-reflection became the basis of the bureaucratic culture, basic of the system, which we are still using and benefit. It means, so you know that the results of the Neo-Confucianism in the Middle Ages was examinations, the idea of civil servant, the merit-based bureaucratic system, development of the merit-based bureaucratic system. In the West, the idea and the culture of self-reflection was enriched by the European mysticism culture, beginning from the Meisterhard to Nicolas von Cusa. And so the understanding of self-reflection become a kind of something common to the both civilizations. In Europe, then, the Platonian definition of the self-reflection found continuous in Enlightenment, in coffee and literary salons, in coffee shops, and then with the democracy system and liberalism. And that's what I'm trying to say, that the commonality, the self-reflection is that is common between all cultures and between every civilization we are known. And this is a kind of the positive positive definition of the self-reflection. But also there exists a negative definition that self-reflection as institution and practice in both civilizations and world is banned and forbid by dictators and totalitarian systems. So this process, so the institutionalization of the self-reflection is very common. And also common, there is a common attitude toward self-institutionalization of the self-reflection. As I am just the big part of my life, just I spent in Soviet Union, so I know how this contradiction to the self-reflection has worked there. And I know that here are my colleagues who also remember this from the times of the Soviet Union and the Soviet camp. The genetics, pathoanalysis, molecular biology, so everything which just drive you to the self-reflection and to the better understanding of yourself was forbidden in the Soviet Union. And also, there was in Soviet Union attempt to marginalization of the self-reflection, and the attitudes toward intelligentsia is just a good example of this. So self-reflection is means to think on yourself, to know what you can and what you cannot, your strengths, and also know your friends and your enemies, and also know your neighbors. So this is a brilliant instrument for know all these things, and also to develop yourself. And the self-reflection is the thing which is bettering yourself. And when we're speaking about the institutionalizing of the self-reflection, it means we're speaking about the creation of the institutions which are bettering themselves, so self-bettering institutions. And on the difference, just not to leave it as a just only words, I can just tell you some examples what the institutionalization of the self-reflection means. For example, on education level, it means to teach students how to develop themselves, how to avoid prejudices, and how to identify prejudices. On technology levels, it means to find easy and effective ways to better environment and human's life. And on governmental level, it means to create a system for free conciseness, choice, and equal possibilities for every citizen. Through this lens, through the lens of the institutionalizing of self-reflection, we can communicate, easily can communicate with each other, the people who represent different cultures, because all we can find some encouraging examples in our history of the institutionalizing of self-reflection. And what is, sorry? I think I should skip to the. Can somebody find my presentation here? Which nobody? Okay. Sorry. No problem. Can you find the Kenyan presentation which was here?
Yeah. Sure. Okay. One second. Is this here? Okay.
No, that not. Another one.
No.
What's this one? Yeah. No. So this one. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I want this. Okay. Good. I'll try as I can find. So my presentation with my computer, I can transfer it to this computer. Anyway, so the main idea of my presentation is that the self-reflection, and you can't. For example, when we're speaking with the totalitarian regimes and totalitarian systems, so say, looking through lens of the institutionalization of the self-reflection will be very productive. Because, for example, you can simulate freedom easily, but you can't simulate the absence of the self-criticism and the introduction of the self-criticism in the textbooks. You can't hide and simulate the absence of the free elections and the political free choice, and you can't simulate the absence of the, for example, financing of the environmental and healthcare programs. So it means that in this case, if we begin to think about the about our cultures as the processes, as the common processes, but of course different processes of the institutionalization of the self-reflection, we can just grow up to the great synergy, which will be based on the cooperation and not cohabitation, the understanding and not tolerating. And I think that this is a quite an interesting way through which we can just understand each other, understand ourselves better, and just creating a mirror not only for ourselves but also for our friends and colleagues. So thank you very much.